Once again for today, welcome everybody. Lovely again to have you with us, and again to see all your beautiful faces. And I guess while people are still arriving, that's a good thing. So I'm very mindful that we have some great, we've had great heritage here in the Mid-North Coast, because we've had people, the traditional owners of the land, who've looked after the land for years and years and years, centuries and millennia. And we are so grateful. We're living in what they have looked after for us for so many years. So we acknowledge their presence past, now, and also into the future, and those who are emerging. So we're grateful for it. We've also got some news items, and I might as well give you the news items before we really commence today. One of the biggest ones I think that's coming up is the presbytery retreat that you're probably well aware of by now, because I've been telling you every week for the last few weeks. So it's going to be good. I'm really looking forward to it. And we've got them, all of the Saltbush people lined up, the three main Saltbush people. They'll be coming along and having a chat to us. And I guess it'll give us also the opportunity of being able to ask questions and such. So that will be really awesome. Now, that's on the 17th to the 19th of September. And we're really looking forward to having you join us. We've got quite a lineup already of people who have applied, but we can still take more. So if you're interested, please let us know. Either let myself know and I can forward things on to Mari, or get in touch with Mari or John Thornton. And that's Mari Battle or John Thornton. And we'd love to be able to have you join us there, because I think it's going to be well worthwhile. I don't think there's anything in particular. We've got some good news stories coming up later on today, so that will be good also. And if you've got, again, good news stories, please let me know. Yesterday at Presbytery was just pretty exciting, because we had some lovely good news stories being told, and it's wonderful. It just lifts our spirit, I think, when we hear good things that are going on, how God's working in our midst. So that's just wonderful. So let's just bring our attention and our focus now into our presence with God. Just sit for a while and allow yourself to just be calm. Allow yourself to settle. Maybe take a deep breath. Oh, and as you let it go, allow any tension that might be in your body or any thoughts to just float away. And now, knowing that God is always with us, the Spirit has been given to us, the Spirit is all around us, in us, through us, between us. The Spirit of God knows no bounds. We live in the Spirit. So we speak to you this morning, Spirit. You are our God of love and compassion. And you're so worthy of our praise. You never fail to keep your promises to us. And we thank you that we have the privilege to see in Jesus' life your love, justice, mercy, provision, and victory. You lift us up when we're weighed down. You provide for all of us in every way. Our overwhelming desire is to praise you as long as we live. So inhabit our praises today, as we gather here through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Love. far. Moved by the sound of his voice and seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. And through it all, it is well. So let go. and it is well with me.
Cannot solve it. There is no mountain too tall. He cannot move it. There is no storm too dark. God cannot calm it. There is no sorrow too deep. He cannot soothe it. If he carry the weight of the world upon his shoulders, I know, my brother, that he will carry you. If he carry the weight of the world upon his shoulders, I know, my sister, that he will carry you. He said, come unto me, all who are weary, and cannot solve it. There is no mountain too tall. He cannot move it. There is no storm too dark. God cannot calm it. There is no sorrow.
I mentioned earlier, we had some beautiful testimonies yesterday of God's presence and God working in the lives of people. I wanted to mention just one of them today, and that was one that Penny Archer had sent to me. And she was talking, she mentioned it yesterday also, that Bob Milton from Southwest Rocks, had been leading a team, a small team for several weeks up to Urunga to be able to prepare the op shop there for reopening and regathering. So it was quite amazing. Apparently every time he'd go up there, he'd come back and he'd ring Penny, and he was so excited at what they'd achieved together. So it just shows us, I suppose, what we can do across the presbytery, not just in our own location, but caring for people and seeing needs and just being able to go to that need and fulfill that if that's a thing that you're able to do and you've seen it. So we've got more to come, more good news stories. And again, if you've got one in particular that you can think of, please send it along, and I'd love to be able to share them as well. You know, I know that I sometimes get down on myself for being not the person that I'd like to be, and I'm presuming that the rest of us are human as well, and we do things that we don't really like to do. And just like Paul said, you know, he does the things he doesn't want to do, and he doesn't do the things that he does want to do. So it's a bit convoluted sometimes. But we have a God who loves us and forgives us far beyond all of that. So I want to take the time now in this place where we are with each other in spirit, but we're also in God in the spirit. So please pray with me. God of healing and God of wholeness, we do confess that we fall into awful things sometimes through our thoughts and our words and our deeds. We bring our brokenness today to you. We bring our sinfulness, our fears, our despairs, and we lay them at your feet. God of healing, God of wholeness, hear our heart's cry. We hold out our hearts and our hands, our minds and our souls, to feel your touch and to know your peace, the peace that only you can bring. God of healing and God of wholeness, in this precious moment, in your presence and your power, grant us faith and confidence that here with you today, our broken lives are made whole. So hear from 1 John 1:9. This is our assurance, friends. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Remember, Christ died for our sins, and he made full atonement for us. We are forgiven, and we have the promise of eternal life. Feel that forgiveness in your heart today. We are his children, friends. Amen. We're going to have the Bible reading today, and Lofa's going to share it with us. Excellent. Thanks, Lofa.
Good morning, everyone. a reading from Genesis 22, verse 1 to 14. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham," and he said, "Here I am." He said, "Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young man, "Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there and we will worship, and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood off the burnt offering and laid on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father, "Abraham, father." And he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide," as it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks, Lofa. That's great. Now we're going to hear a reflection, which is pretty exciting, from Jessie. And I'm looking forward to this because she may let you know, but she's also going to be presenting this as part of her homiletics subject that she's doing at the moment. So we're being benefited, I think, and graciously shown what her thoughts are on this subject. Thanks, Jess.
Thank you. Thank you, Cherie. Thank you, Lofa. So we're back to Genesis. This passage was suggested as one for our class to consider and study on. And from that, I've prepared this for you this morning, and with the Spirit, I trust. And I ask you now to pray with me. Holy Spirit, we gathered around the scripture to hear your word for us today. Be in my speaking, be in our listening, be active in our hearts, for the sake of Christ. Amen. This story is pretty difficult. The story can be quite chilling, but it ends so beautifully. It starts and proceeds so straightforward, and all the characters are so definite in their words and their actions. So many are happy to gloss over the story with its happy ending, or to make it somehow point to another story altogether. But if we do that, we miss a lot that this passage of scripture can show us. What happens if we pause, look into it a bit, and let some questions come up instead? Now, the story begins by telling us God was testing Abraham. But why did God need to test Abraham when God had already blessed Abraham, said he'd become a great nation, and gifted him a son? Does God test all of us this way? Do Abraham and Isaac really not think twice before going right to the brink of such unthinkable horror? For what purpose is this story of near horror even here? Was Abraham mistaken about what God wanted? How can we know in our testing times which way God would have us go? When the Christian couple, who'd learned that their son was living with another man, not as a housemate, but as a partner, called their son to meet them for coffee, which way was God calling them to go? The mother, looking at her son across the cafe table, tells him she won't be part of his sinful life, demands that he hand over the key, his key to the family home, walks away. It's 12 years later that the son, Chris, is finally able to talk with them again. He comes for a visit, and when he tells them in front of reality TV cameras that he's engaged to a man in America and gives them plane tickets to come to the wedding, is God testing them? Which is the way God would want them to go? The new ministry student, progressing through training in response to a sense of call, receives a phone call from a second organisation saying they won't have her there for field placement because of her past. Is that a sign from God or a test? What if this keeps happening? Would that mean it wasn't God drawing her on that path after all? What does God want her to do? In our story from Genesis, Abraham is told to go to the land of Moriah, which means place of teaching. From start to finish, he doesn't seem to have any questions. When he hears God instruct him, take your son, your treasured son, and make of him a burnt offering, he doesn't argue or ask a thing. It's so unlike his previous behavior. When he and Isaac get to the place, he builds an altar, lays firewood on it, ties up his son, puts him on top of the firewood, doesn't stop to wonder at all, as he had done when God promised him this son. Doesn't utter a word of request. Oh God, can there be another way? There's no remonstrating with God. Will you indeed have this child you gave me put to death? He'd remonstrated that way for the city of Sodom and thereby saved the life of his nephew, Lot. No, his mouth is silent, even as he reaches out his hand and takes the knife toward his son. Abraham seems absolutely clear. With every incredible step he takes, it seems he's got the whole picture, has the outcome clear in sight, and he knows exactly what God wants. But does he? The angel of the Lord stops him when he's about to do what he heard God tell him to do. So it's not looking so clear, that path that Abraham takes, nor that he really did know what God wanted. So at this place of teaching that Abraham goes to, let's see what we can learn with him, as the Judaic theologians have done for centuries. Some of them see that Abraham's story teaches us that what we hear may not be exactly God's intention. And that, like Abraham, for us to walk the spiritual path means to wrestle with, what does God expect of me? According to Midrash, the ancient interpretations of scripture, this whole journey may have started by Satan prodding God into proving, testing Abraham, like the story of Job. Or it may have even been a matter of Abraham testing God right back, both seeing how far the other would go. It also could be that Abraham was mistaken about what God wanted. He may have simply believed that God wanted the sacrifice of his son, because that's what the other peoples in the region believed and did. Grim evidence shows it was horrifyingly common, the sacrifice of children. At the place of teaching, Abraham, and therefore all his descendants, are shown otherwise. This is not what God wants. It is the Lord who stops him, the Lord who says, "Do not harm the child." And when Abraham stops, he finally looks up and sees the ram in the thicket. He sees that what is needed, the Lord has seen to, has provided. The Lord. In some Bibles, it is Adonai. In Hebrew, it is the holy name Yahweh, the sacred I am as I am, revealed in intensely intimate relationship with Abraham, and most gloriously to Moses, as a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. This is what Abraham comes to see in the land of teaching. His, our gracious, intimate God of love. He learns to lift his eyes and see what God has seen to for his life of faith. So Abraham called that place Yahweh Yireh, on the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. Or the Lord will see to it. Like Abraham, we in our testing times may not know exactly what God is wanting with us. We can't see the outcome we're heading to. Often we're not sure, after all, that what God was really up to in calling us on this journey. Have you been confronted with a sudden crucial crossroads, a heart-dropping letdown, a sudden upheaval that throws bewildering fog over your once clear path? Or found yourself looking around at the features of where you are and thinking, "This does not look like what I thought God was sending me to"? When, like Abraham, our hearts are called to the place of teaching, if we stop and look to God, who is in attentive relationship with us, we'll see how God has provided for our path of faith. Those Christian parents, suddenly invited to their gay son's wedding in front of TV cameras, they opted for words of rejection, refusal and rejection. Their heartbroken son, Chris, asked, "Is it worth sacrificing your relationship with me because of your beliefs?" But then last year, the mother learned she had just months left of life on earth. Their perspective of God's priorities changed. Now they seek relationship with their son. Now they see they can love not just him, but his husband too. Before she dies, Chris's mother tells him so. At her funeral, his father hugs Chris and his husband and thanks his husband. The ministry student who was denied a field placement. In prayer, she found her heart turned back from its fear response and saw instead a patient trust. Supportive people kept appearing on her path. Ways have been found through recurring obstacles. There's still some uncertainty about the end point, but she says she has peace about walking not toward a known outcome, but in faith. Let us remember, when times are testing, to look and see that the Lord has seen to what we need. Not a crystal ball, not the power to turn things around, and probably not a ram in a thicket, but provision for our life of faith. The things internally and externally that sustain us in our walk. Or as written in the second letter of Peter, divine power has given us everything needed for life in devotion, through the knowledge of the one who called us to God's own glory and goodness. Look up, look around and within you. God has seen to the things, the people, the spirit you need. Look and see the God of gracious relationship and say with Abraham, Yahweh, Yireh, in the Lord it is provided. Amen.
Thank you very much, Jessie. That was a blessing to us. So I think later we'll discuss some of that. I'm looking forward to being able to go into our chat rooms and discuss it. Thank you.
You've shown us, O God, what is good. You have shown us, O Lord, what you require. You have heard all our songs of how we long to worship you. Yet you told us the offering you desire. To do justly, to love mercy, to walk humbly with you, God. You have shown us the riches of your love. You have shown us your heart for those in and the broken, to the widow and the orphan, let the river of your justice flow through us. Let your river flow, let your river flow, let your river flow through us. You said to do justly, to love mercy, to walk humbly with you, God. You said to do justly.
ahead, have our prayers of the people now, and Lofa is going to take us through. Thank you, Lofa.
Let us pray. God, our provider and sustainer, as we gather this morning and connect virtually, we bring to you our concerns and our struggles. In the past, you have journeyed with our ancestors, and regardless of our confusions and uncertainty about whether you are with us, you have been there to provide, to sustain our life in all the different ways that it's taken us. God, our provider, hear our prayers. Compassionate One, help us to bear with the ills of the world. Give us the strength to hold all the hurt and harm, all the suffering and pain, all the brokenness and all the sadness. God, be our strength and heart to hold ourselves and others in your love. And as we open our hearts to others, grant us the strength that we need to exercise compassion. Bear the weight for us to bear the weight of empathy as we seek bear each other's burdens. God, our provider, hear our prayers. God, our comfort and strength, share our burdens. Bring around us in our community the support that is needed so that we might carry each other and draw on each other in our weakness, so that all who need care are cared for, all who weep and mourn are comforted, all who suffer are supported, and all who are ill are helped, and all who struggle are empowered to seek you. God, our provider, hear our prayers. God, hear us when we weep, when there is sadness. See us when we mourn with shared losses. Hear us when we lament that which is not right. Comfort us when things overwhelm us. Be with us and bless us, so that we might join with you in being with others and blessing with them. This we pray with all our hearts. Amen.
Thank you very much, Lofa. Most appreciated. We have another song for you now.
Built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Covenant his blood, support me in the whelming flood.
come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. The solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
So we've come to the end of the official part of the service, but that's not the end altogether. We'll have chat groups shortly, and hopefully you can have a question. And the question is based on Jessie's preach to us or her reflection to us. And I just wrote down, where has been your place of teaching? Where have you been stopped by God and had to reevaluate your situation? Just like Abraham did. So with that in mind, let's just thank God and be blessed. So Ephesians 3, 17 to 19 tells us that may Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness.